Good afternoon. My name's Scott McDonald. I'm Senior Associate Dean for Arts and Humanities in the College of Arts and Sciences here at Cornell. It's my privilege and honor to welcome you all here this afternoon. We have a lot to celebrate. We are in a new space. For some of you, I imagine this is your first time in this space. It's been in use for just 2 or 3 months, and we're still breaking it in. It's a magnificent space, and we're very proud of it, and we're very proud to have you in it today for this particular purpose. So we're celebrating this space. We're celebrating the humanities this semester in the College of Arts and Sciences, in part because the new humanities building of which this space is a part is opened newly at the beginning of this term. So we have a whole slate of events celebrating the humanities. We're also celebrating today the virtual conferral of a new PhD. I understand that just a couple of hours ago, Paula Vogel successfully defended her dissertation at Cornell. Congratulations. So there's a lot to celebrate. I got the leverage to force Sara Warner to ask me to welcome you today in the following way. In October of the past fall, I sent out a note to several humanities faculty in the college asking them for ideas about how to celebrate the humanities this spring semester. And very quickly, Paula shot back a 3-page long proposal about bringing Paula Vogel here to have her defend her dissertation finally, to do this conversation today, to have the open staging of her play Indecent tomorrow. Came back very quickly, and almost as quickly as that came back, it occurred to me that that's exactly the sort of thing we were looking for to celebrate the humanities at Cornell this semester. So I shot back fairly quickly to Sara saying, can we claim this as our own in the college? And Sara, I'm happy to say, agreed to let us in on the magnificence of it. So here we are. It's an incredible honor for the college and for the university to have Paula Vogel with us today and tomorrow. And it's an incredible opportunity. It's an opportunity to celebrate one of our most distinguished living alumni, MA 81, I understand, and PhD 2016. Yeah. That's a gap. It's an opportunity to celebrate one of the longest graduate careers I'm familiar with, almost 40 years, or maybe over 40 years. When did you arrive, Paul? 42 years. Yeah, surely, perhaps not a record, but surely in the top few. And it's an opportunity to engage with this remarkable and remarkably important playwright and one of her extraordinary pieces of work. So without further ado, I'm going to hand the microphone over to people who can do real introductions and talk knowledgeably about these important matters. Let me just say, welcome from the College of Arts and Sciences. We're delighted you're here, and we're looking forward to 2 glorious days. Thank you, Paula, for being with us.
Thank you so much, Scott, for being with us and for that lovely introduction. I'm Nick Salvato, the Chair of Performing and Media Arts, and like Scott, I want to express the sentiment of the feeling of honor and pleasure and privilege to be here welcoming all of you today. We will move on very shortly to the staged conversation, and I'll do introductions to set us up for that. But first, I want to circle back to something that Scott mentioned, which was that we had a defense this afternoon. And it was not only a fun and funny and brilliant and moving conversation, but also one in which Paula's mentor from the 1970s, Marvin Carlson, was able to participate. And we want to take advantage of Marvin's presence with us here today, also to celebrate this year's Carlson Award. So we have an award for the best piece of student writing in theater and performance studies that we give every year, and Marvin is with us today, and we'll ask him to come up and congratulate this year's winners. We have a winner and an honorable mention. So I think both of those folks are here. Yeah? So Marvin, do you want to join me here? So the winner of this year's Carlson Award is Kristen Wright for an essay called The Killing of My Mother, I Shall Claim Myself, Adrian Kennedy's Electra and Orestes, Aeschylus Oresteia, and The Question of Justice. Kristen? And an honorable mention for this year's Carlson Award goes to Stephen Lowe for an essay entitled The Liberating Theatrical Femininity of Nina Arsenault. I know Marvin wants to say a few words, so I'll hand the microphone to him.
I couldn't let the occasion go past without saying a few words, as you and anybody who knows me will not be surprised. First of all, of course, my great pleasure at this wonderful event. My warmest congratulations and love to Paula, one of my favorite people. And I, at first, I thought a little embarrassed about horning the Marvin Carlson Awards into this, and then I thought, no, it's very appropriate. As the dean said at the beginning, Paula and I have had through Cornell an intertwined relationship going back to the very beginning of her career, and the wonderful play that she did here, Desdemona, that went on to win a major award at the Kennedy Center, and on through 40 years, when not only was she gestating a Ph.D., but becoming one of the most distinguished and awarded playwrights in the United States. Not a bad 40 years. But the other thing I want to say, in fact, is about the awards. And not only do I feel honored and fulfilled in being a part of Paula's career and a part of this occasion, but also to say that it is a tremendous satisfaction to me to once again be back at Cornell at a time when there is a very strong nationally recognized PhD program, which was very much the case when I was here and when Paula was here and when David Saverin was here, who is also with us. These were golden years of the Cornell PhD program, and it is a delight to see that tradition now going on again very, very solidly under the work of the very distinguished faculty headed by Sara and Nick, with Ellen and others as well. That's a great reward. But even that is not all. There's other convergences. And I have to say, I'm honored and delighted by the establishment of this award. I have read with enormous pleasure the winners of the award each year. This year with particular pleasure because the winners are so appropriate. That is to say, They not only are the excellent awards, but they converge almost phenomenally with Paula's interests and commitments. An award for one of the most important Black African American women playwrights in the United States, and of course minority playwrights and women playwrights are both central concerns of Paula and central causes that she has championed. But another cause, and of course another cause that she has championed that I only found out about yesterday, is not just international drama, which I knew, but Canadian drama, which I did not know. And how appropriate then that the other award, the honorable mention, was not only of a Canadian performance artist, but a transgender Canadian performance artist. And aside from their own intrinsic merits, I cannot think of two papers on two subjects that would be more suitable to the particular occasion we have today. So I congratulate those winners. I congratulate the faculty for encouraging them and giving them these awards. And I know Paula would join with me in saying we are honored that they are part of this celebration as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Marvin. So I think it's time to welcome our honored guest and friends to the stage. Paula Vogel, as has already been intimated, needs no further introduction in any special way for me. You know her as one of our most important and treasured playwrights, and she will be in conversation today with my colleague Sara Warner, an associate professor in performing and media arts, a wonderful teacher and mentor, and a brilliant writer in her own right. Among her other accomplishments is the award-winning book, Acts of Gaiety. And joining both Sara and Paula is another alumnus of our Ph.D. program, an accomplished director, dramaturg, and playwright, Meghan, who received her Ph.D. here in 2010 and is currently a visiting assistant professor at Ursinus. Meghan is back with us to direct the concert reading of Paula's play, Indecent, which will happen here tomorrow. Not as previously and erroneously announced at 4:30, but rather at 5 o'clock. So if that's not correct in your calendars, please update that. Paula was working on hiding scenes in Restoration Comedy when she was in her original incarnation with us as a graduate student in the 1970s. And the dissertation, which she beautifully, brilliantly defended this afternoon, is in fact Indecent, a play that has a wonderful critical framing for the purpose of filing for the dissertation, and I think is an amazing example of doing theater history and theater theory by other means through a very dense and layered and evocative piece of dramatic writing. So you're going to hear more about Indecent and Paula's career and various other related things now, as I get out of the way and let our wonderful colleagues take the stage, with a special thank you for Sara's tireless work to make all of this possible.
Yes. Yeah.
Hello, everybody. So, Paula, Dr. Vogel,
how did you myself?
It's only been an hour.
Yes.
How does it feel? What does it mean to you to have the degree?
I'm honored to be your colleague, your colleagues. I'm honored to be marching with you and with Stephen. There we are. I'm honored to be mentored by this department and this faculty. It's an incredible act of generosity. So I'm very, very proud. And as soon as the play is over, I will catch up with all of your critical works, which I'm really looking forward to. And I want to just say, in terms of what Marvin is saying, I really was very lucky to be here at this time in the way that I think people are lucky to be here now. And it means a lot to see this department and the caretaking you're giving. And I do want to thank you. It's really been very generous of your time. So it means a lot. It's going to take a while for me to believe it, I think, or for me to unpack, as it were. Yeah.
Well, we feel like we won the lottery, so it's fantastic.
Thank you.
So tell us about this play that you both discovered as graduate students in Cornell, some 35 years apart. What is it about this play that captured your imagination and that you wanted to write a play about it and you wanted to center your dissertation on it?
First, I'd love to hear.
Yeah. Okay, is that on?
Yeah.
There we go. I think that it was a very transitional moment for me when I was a student here. I was planning on doing a dissertation on Sophie Treadwell. Thanks, Ellen, for hanging in there with me during the first half of that. And then I started, I was reading other plays in Ellen's class, and I'm pretty sure that as an extension of that, I came across The God of Vengeance and was sort of shocked and incredibly excited and bewildered all at the same time. And that began me on my journey, which was essentially looking at depictions of lesbianism on Broadway from 1920 to 1945. And I think more than the sort of historical curiosity that the play fostered in me was also a profound moment of seeing, of recognition of lesbian characters that predate the 1920s, and sort of hard to put into words, seeing yourself reflected in drama when you don't often see that, or if you do, you cringe. And it was neither of those moments, and really launched for me a huge portion of my academic career that I'm still exploring today.
Yeah. When I was in high school in the South, it wasn't a particularly safe time to be out. But what I would do is about once a week, I had my mother's signature on a request for sick leave for me. And I kept the letter, and then I wrote additional letters and traced her signature. And I would take a sick day every week and go down to the Library of Congress, where, God bless these librarians, they would bring this 15-year-old girl sitting in the stacks, out-of-print lesbian novels from the 20s and 30s and 40s. And quite frankly, the only thing that I read that didn't encourage immediate suicide at that point in these lesbian pulp novels was a book called Price of Salt by Claire Morgan that I've always wanted to adapt. But now I don't have to worry about that because of the movie Carol. So flash forward coming here, and Marvin, I cannot recall if it was you or if it was Bert, but one of my committee members said, you know, you should read The God of Vengeance. So I remember going into the Rockefeller and getting The God of Vengeance and standing. I was too wrapped up to sit. And I read the second act of this play in 1974. And I was literally talking back to the play. This was written in 1906. A young married man wrote this? Of all the things I'd been reading out of print in the Library of Congress, the love between these two women was the most remarkable thing I'd encountered. No apology for it. It was absolutely presented as this beautiful phenomenon. It was, in fact, the locus of purity in the entire play, this redemption between two women. So that was my encounter, and boy, I could never forget that. And I think that's probably true, right, for all of us who read the play.
It has always stayed with me, I think, in many ways. And it's just incredibly beautiful in so many ways. And then to look at that in contrast to all of the sexological material that's making its way into sort of the mm-hmm. public consciousness at that time. And it stands alone, even among the other plays that are dealing with lesbianism on Broadway at that time, and is more revolutionary in its depictions than any of the plays that came after it for the next 25 years. And again, yeah, married man who just sits down, and that's what pops out.
So why, I ask you this in the dissertation, but I think folks here will want to know, why write a play about the making of the play and not just adapt the play or transform the play that way? Why was it important to you to have actual elements of that play in your play and to tell the story in a broader context?
Well, first of all, I just think that we as a culture, society, feel that sexuality is something that was discovered last week. And certainly our parents and our grandparents and our great parents never knew of that. And one of the things that I think is really important about incorporating the play
play is precisely that, that this is written in 1906. We are, it feels exactly, it's rather like, in a way, thinking of Wojciech and Buchner's manuscript that does feel like it could have been written last week, but in fact is more than 100 years old. So one of the things I wanted was just to kind of give the audience that sensation or that just remarkable thrill of this, these two characters, of this love that I think up to this moment in time is still the most, one of the most beautiful presentations of love. So just out of, I say this really, I really consider my play product placement for the God of Vengeance. I'm really hoping that if this play is seen and done, that people will think, we should be doing God of Vengeance. Let's go back and read the God of Vengeance and produce the God of Vengeance. I think it works as well today as it did then. And actually, it's a much more layered, complicated, complex play than that beautiful transcendent second act. This is a play that formed the basis for one of the most famous obscenity trials in the United States. In 1923, this play, which had been traveling all through Europe, all to Russia, you name it, everywhere on the globe, London, without really any remarkable incidents to stop, a controversial play, played for years downstairs in the downtown in the Yiddish theater, and someone got the bright idea, why don't we translate this into English and perform it on Broadway? And opening night, the entire cast was arrested and put in jail for obscenity. Many people may mistake that the obscenity was actually the love between the two women. The true obscenity was that a Yiddish writer at a time of fierce anti-Semitism in this country did not censor himself and wrote about the Jewish sex trade. Again, quite forthrightly, without any apology, looked at violence against women, and looked at his use of the Torah. He basically, the play says, you know, you can buy religion for a price. Religion is just another commodity on the marketplace, and Jews are no different than Catholics and Protestants. So at this point in time, 1923, when the Know Nothing Party has risen, right? We've got the KKK having a huge revival. We've got Henry Ford producing unbelievable diatribes against immigration and the evils of immigration and the polluting of pure Americanism by these hordes of immigrants. To do this particular play and not censor it and put it out there is both a remarkable act of bravery and foolishness, I think in equal part. And one of the things that I feel that I wanted to present, you know, I've now been fortunate to work with playwrights for the last 40 years. And so after the last four decades, there is always a remarkable young man or woman who comes forward in workshop with pages that it's like you're lighting a fuse of a bomb. And you bring the bomb into workshop and say, hey, I want us to read my bomb today. And you all pay attention and you all sit there and you all present the play. And then in that aftermath, you say, we have to produce this play. But you have to know what's going to happen when we produce the play. And what you have to do when you are presenting incendiary material, which is necessary in the theater to present. So I've now seen this amazing, I can probably mention the playwrights that exploded their plays in as young writers. I think one of the things that's important to me is for us to look at the material and realize that it continues to be incendiary, but we are not doing our duties as participants, as citizens in this country, to present incendiary work. And because we have not had that courage, I feel that we have
democracy is eroding right now. I don't think we really think of ourselves as a democracy. I think we think of ourselves as we are, as an oligarchy. It seems to me that one of the important functions of theater is that it is taking incendiary subjects that are controversial, that are divisive, and airing our laundry in public. And that is exactly what this play does. If we did a faithful adaptation of God and Vengeance right now, that's exactly the impact it would have on us. So for me, this is kind of Sholem Ash and God of Vengeance is sort of a profile in courage in this young man stepping forward and not censoring it. It was censored, but not by him. I don't know how you feel about that.
I completely agree. I teach the God of Vengeance in Butches, Bitches, and Buggers, a survey of queer drama.
Love that title.
It started here, actually. I'm not sure how it got into the catalog. It's the first play that my students read in that class. And immediately, this very semester, they asked, well, we should do this. We need to do this. And they immediately on reading it can draw comparisons to Dr. Brodie, Trump, and the play, and this idea of what is American, and what is wholesome for everyone else. And we read reviews of it as we work through the play together, and they see it immediately as timely and something that affects them on a day-to-day basis. And that's incredibly exciting for me. And they know that, yeah, early 20th century. And they routinely say, this defied all of my expectations when you had me read this. They were like, I was like, waiting, and there are questions. Where are the lesbians? You said there'd be, whoa! And they could pretty much all tell you on what page in the Forbidden Desire anthology that popped up, and suddenly they were all thrilled and excited. And I love to start there because they also expect... They expect things to become more controversial as we, and it doesn't. It doesn't become more controversial than the God of Vengeance. And we get to the captive, and they're like, we like the God of Vengeance better. I understand why. Trust me, it doesn't get better. It's going to continue to get worse throughout the decades of this class, unfortunately. But we can use that as a touchstone. So my students' enthusiasm for it always renews my interest in it and makes me look at it in new ways and think about how I can make it accessible to other people. And probably we should put on a production of it.
Yes. And speaking of it doesn't get better, there were more female playwrights and more experimental content before women had the right to vote. There were more plays by women being produced than there are now. So we can't even catch up to where we were in the 19-teens. How can we have such a gender gap in the theater that that is so relentless and persistent? It's a chronic condition. It's not a crisis. I mean, we have to stop calling it a crisis because it doesn't get any better. We had a brief blip in the 80s with Wendy Wasserstein and Beth Henley and some other female dramatists making big, big splashes, and the rest of us are toiling. Why is that, Paula, do you think?
Oh, let me say this carefully. I often think that there are theater companies that I've encountered where instead of having artistic directors, you have emperors and empresses. What's very interesting is that the way theater companies are set up, it's rigidly hierarchical. And there is nothing wrong with long tenures in the theater for artistic directors. There are some artistic directors who have been artistic directors for 30, 40, 50 years, and I wish they'd continue. Because they understand being an artistic director is to listen to the culture and respond to the culture, rather than being a gatekeeper. And the truth of the matter is there are a lot of gatekeepers out there.
And one of the biggest gatekeeper, of course, is being produced on Broadway. That's a very, very high glass ceiling that impacts the economics of theater greatly. And there are so many women writers I love. We were just talking about Lynn Nottage, whom I'm hoping everyone gets to have a conversation with. I think she's a genius. I've loved every play she's written. I think, as we would say, it's a shonda, a shame for American drama that she's not been produced on Broadway, that all of her work is not more visible. The thing that's kind of shocking to me is that the gatekeeping seems to be getting more extreme in the arts, which we tend to think of as a progressive culture, and less extreme in corporations. Mm-hmm. Or at least there's more window dressing in corporations. The corporate model now is underwriting theater as much as it is the studio film. And in fact, what's happened is that studio films, which are just large corporations, I mean, it's, you know, it's Sony Pictures, have in a way become the model for how to produce Broadway entertainment. If you look and see how Broadway is produced, it's actually a lot of film companies now. So what's kind of very interesting, like I like to watch advertisements on TV. I'm really curious in the moment of time. I think there's not a better reflection of the moment in time than to see what the marketing approach is. Have you folks seen the marketing approach where a man is dressed in a beautiful morning coat and he gets in the car with a young woman and they drive to the church? And she helps him with the flower and his lapel and they go into the church and you think, this is her father. And he's giving his daughter away, and they walk down the aisle, and there is an older man waiting for her father. And the daughter gives the two men, she gives her father to his groom. You know, here, I'm now my mother's age where I start to weep at these ads. I'm like, oh. Or, I mean, it's very interesting right now that in terms of capitalism, what is happening is that there are multiple paradigms in terms of lifestyles and families. And if you look at American drama and what's winning prizes and what's transferring to Broadway, or what is getting, pardon me, I'm trying not to lose my temper, what is getting nominated for the Oscar, we see more and more exclusion. So I'm not answering the question. I'm noting that it's happening, that it seems as if we're arrows going in divergent directions right now in terms of drama. And part of the reason, I will say for theater, is that the only way to underwrite it right now, the only way, because we have effectively allowed the NEA to be dismantled by the Republican Congress of Jesse Helms, that what has happened is that foundations and corporations have taken a step back as a result of Mapplethorpe and the NEA4. And the only people who've stepped up are individuals with money who, instead of being a philanthropist the way philanthropists I met in the 1960s, saying, here's money, you must do what you must do, are saying, here's my check, and I better not be upset this season by another play that is an affront to my politics. And that message is given directly with the check. So that's where we are right now. We've eroded all public, a lot, most of the public support for the sciences and for the arts. I mean, this is also horrific right now in terms of scientific research.
So perhaps the university is the place we should be changing that paradigm. What should we be teaching and what should we be staging in a university theater department? Besides plays by Paula Vogel.
No, that's very appreciated too, but I have a long list.
I think, unfortunately, I know at my previous institution, the first question I'm asked when I propose a show for a college or university season is, will this sell tickets, Meghan? Do you really think our audiences are going to come see this play? And It's not a musical, so I've got one check there. And for my career so far, I've said it's cheesy. I like cheese, but I really do want to be the change that I want to see in the world. So I direct plays exclusively by women. And I didn't really think that was that big of a deal until I got a lot of pushback about it. Why does it have to be a play by a woman? Can't you read? Like, no one asked you, lovely 75-year-old gentleman who has been in this department since its inception, why you've directed plays by men for the last 45 years without exception. No one asks that. But those, the politics of Broadway has sort of fallen down. We see it in regional theater now, and we see it in colleges and on university campuses, where the idea is that you'll support yourself with your ticket sales. So without administrative support for us to be experimental and for us to do the sort of work that challenges students and also motivates students to write and to do something different and gives them permission to do that in an environment where they have faculty mentors supporting them, then we're stuck with a season of Arthur Miller, Heinrich Ibsen, and the occasional Tennessee Williams thrown in to get us excited. And there's nothing wrong with any of those playwrights, but for that to be the exclusive landscape is frightening. And for me to have to fight to put on productions and then also be my own marketing person and take on another job to ensure that there are butts in the seat so I can direct another play that I want to direct the next year is problematic, to say the least. And so I'm still navigating a path forward for that sort of freedom.
All right, I'm hearing what you're saying, and I don't know how you feel about this, but I think that one of the things that we're doing in universities is we are constructing, there's a false syllogism here. Artists are scholars and scholars are artists. Every person sitting in this audience is an artist. The place for art, the process of making art is in the university, not the process of presenting art. And I think that there is a way that we can engage in exposing the process of making theater in a way, and I'm just gonna say this, it took a while, but David Sarvin worked with me at Brown. We presented the first plays by Lynn Nottage, Nilo Cruz, Sarah Rule, Kiara Houdiz. They were remarkable plays. They were their first plays. We invited people into the readings and the workshops. We invited people into the playwriting workshops that lived in town. I wasn't particularly interested if somebody had paid the tuition for the semester, but I was extremely interested in people who lived in Providence, who wanted to act in the community, write in the community, be artists in the community. And if we can take that down and simply say, what you're seeing is not a production, you're seeing a process. Please be a part of the process. We ended up having to turn people away whenever we did our productions. Now, mind you, we did our productions on $100. That's true. I have seen the most miraculous things on $100. But the truth of the matter is if we, as writers who are emerging, can figure out how to have a collaborative process and construct unbelievably beautiful worlds on $100, $200,000 if we ever get the chance, $500,000 if we ever get the chance at Lincoln Center, I have not, no problem. It's the $100. And that actually requires playwriting by the audience. Because when people come in, you say, we did this in 2 weeks on $100. And what you're seeing is the second play by Deepika Guha, who's been only working 2 weeks with actors and director. You're part of the process. Please give us feedback. Please come back for the next. Here's the playwright. Here are the artists in the lobby. They're there if you want to talk to them. That's, interestingly enough, right now, I feel that one of the directions, and tell me if you think I'm wrong, is that
One of the things that's been happening at universities is we have been removing the interdisciplinary glue of our faculties and our campuses and becoming more corporate in our structures in terms of departments and reducing the kind of imaginative curriculum which is always on your backs on top of your regular load of what you must do with the required curriculum to create that other layer. And we have removed things that allow it to be grown by the young artists who are our students. One of the things that was recently removed, I believe, from Brown that really is the GISP, the group independent study, that anyone after their sophomore year can go to a faculty member and say, I have 10 colleagues. Here is the problem we'd like to investigate. We would like to bring the following artists in. Will you be our sponsor? And they have constructed their own curriculum. They have been, I think, more ruthless and rigorous on those, and remarkable things came out of that. And that was one of the first things to go in the interdisciplinary way that we work. So I don't know that this is every campus. I am very alarmed right now that it feels to me that we're insisting on a business model for things that will never work in a business model. I don't know how you respond to that.
I think that's true. I mean, with budget cuts and new budget models, and I mean, it didn't work for corporations in the 80s. We're paying the price for that now. I don't know why universities are on that bandwagon. It doesn't work. It's antithetical to the nature of a liberal arts education, I think. Absolutely.
Not only doesn't it work, I'm just going to give one. By the way, it's an incredible honor today. I'm realizing in 2008, I was made the Eugene O'Neill Chair of Playwriting at Yale University. And it's not that I wanted tenure. They wouldn't allow me to teach undergraduates that I had taught for 24 years at Brown because I didn't have a Ph.D. And I went forward and argued to the dean and the provost, as well as other colleagues, you know, it'd be quite wonderful if we could tear down the moat between graduate education and undergraduate education and allow this mentorship and this incredible, fertile conversation to happen. And I would love it if you might take my MFA candidates to do an introductory playwriting class. And the dean said, absolutely not, they don't have their PhDs. That's not to be allowed. And I tried for about 2 years and I gave up. And a wonderful colleague up the road at Wesleyan, I said, Claudia, do you think that there'd be any way possible that you could take in 3 playwrights to teach intro to playwriting? And she said, of course. And on top of her course load, she became a mentor to 3 of my writers a year. What happened? They increased their demand and their admissions for every single class in the theater department. And they had to actually do new hires. Because it is the inverse, the limit of supply and demand. If you actually give the supply, the demand increases. One of the ways that we're thinking of budget cuts is to cut something. Because you're only human. I mean, I know what hours you're responding to emails, so I know what that workload is. But if there is a way that we can actually have the conversations between undergraduate and graduate artists who are our students increase the supply, the demand will follow. Does that make sense? And I've seen it. I absolutely believe in it. It's going against the grain right now of how I feel we're looking at administratively at a university education.
Absolutely. And to return to the topic of incendiary subjects for the arts, I don't think there's a topic you haven't tackled. AIDS, incest, prostitution.
If you find something, will you let me know?
Yeah.
I'm looking for the next project after this one. It's been 5 years on this one, so yeah.
And that started from your very first play. I mean, there were very few women in the academy. Feminism was not a topic. Gender studies, feminist studies, female studies, as it was called at Cornell in the good old days, did not exist as a discipline And you forged this, and I think that comes, and it came from the graduate students, is that correct? I mean, because you couldn't get tenure teaching courses like this, so the graduate students were taking this on, and that's just one example of how if you open those floodgates, this is what you get, the flowering of a brand new discipline.
Yes, I mean, one of the things that was astonishing and really overwhelming to me was the ability to start teaching, for example, Mad Women on Stage as one of my courses, as a graduate student, and very particularly mentored by women's studies faculty, so that I could respond to my own graduate curriculum was remarkable. And again, I mean, it's just a moment, it seems to me, a moment in time for us to look at our greatest resources. Our greatest resources are always our students. And so I'm very, you know, so excited when I hear, oh, I'm, you know, our graduate student is directing this, or, you know, there's a seminar that, I mean, that to me is a response that shows the faculty how engaged they are with the conversation that they're having in the curriculum you're giving them, you know?
So how do we, at the same time, give them this freedom and then protect them, or not protect them, is I think they have to learn how to fight themselves, and you know who you are out there, but to prepare them for the pushback, right? The pushback that you got for writing feminist drama, the pushback that they're going to get for writing this, you know, these new forms of knowledge. How do we do that?
Well, I think one of the problems is that we're removing the incendiary moments from our universities that give us the muscle to have a conversation about it. So I'm afraid the only way that we learn about this is by getting in a room, turning on the lights, and having very emotional people talking to each other whose feelings have been trespassed or hurt or outraged. And then kind of trying to be the, to modulate it into a conversation. If we can learn to do that at our universities, there will be pushback. It's much better to have the pushback so that we as artists go, oh, I have to think ahead. Why am I doing this? I have to be ready to explain this. And basically, I mean, I'm still saying this. It's interesting. Pardon me. I know we're in a university. I've been saying for the past 40 years that there are two things that playwrights need to know how to say. And one is thank you, because it's not made by the playwright. It's the generosity of everyone around them. And secondly, we have to say I'm sorry. I've spent 40 years going up to people who are either crying or angry at me and saying, I'm sorry, it wasn't my intention to hurt you, I'm sorry. Please tell me anything you want to tell me in this moment. I can't say it's the most pleasant moments, but I can say it stretched me the most as an artist, and I think that people deserve that if you're doing that. And if we remove that from this environment, how do we learn that outside these walls, right? I recently said this in front of a younger playwriting colleague, Dan O'Brien. He said, there's a third thing you need to learn to say. And I said, what's that? And he said, the F word, you. And I thought, you know, I've got to learn that at this stage in my life to respond that way. So maybe he's right. Maybe that's the third thing.
So oftentimes when we look at these statistics of, you know, less than 20% of plays being produced are by women, we hear, oh, well, women just can't write plays. And the other constant refrain we hear is women aren't funny.
Well, this is
hysterical.
Right. You know, the other thing I've thought about, it's too simplistic, but it was really kind of lovely, is that culturally there's no place for the prodigal daughter, the return of the prodigal daughter. That the return of the prodigal son is a ritual that we embrace nostalgically. And it seems proper, that kind of Oedipal rebellion, which I feel all playwrights should be doing in their 20s. The audience that the playwright is Oedipus is doing this Oedipal rejection. I think it's much harder, and it has been much harder. And comedy, of course, is critique. So whether it's comedy or whether it's playwriting, women in charge of a world that's basically critiquing the world of the father, it is understandably still a very recent time. But I also want to say that there is use for me as a feminist of passing on plays that are highly disturbing to young men and women written by men, such as The God of Vengeance. Or, for example, I don't think I've gone through a single playwriting workshop where I haven't given somebody the play called Christian Love by Howard Brunton. Here, look at this, incredibly disturbing, how this man, it's actually a play about a mass murderer that existed in London. And the characters are this, the site of empathy is the mass murderer, and the police are the monsters around him. This is written in the 1970s, folks. And all of the women are blow-up sex dolls, all of the victims. It is only a one-act play. To this day, when I read it again, I shake. It makes me shake. Do you know what I mean? And to give that to young women and say, I'd like to see a response, please. You know, can you write me 10 pages to Christian Love? Is a remarkable moment, a remarkable. One of the things that I want to really talk about is that I find it very interesting, for example, to say, listen, I know this may be upsetting, but can we read Fassbinder right now? Can we talk about what you're feeling when you encounter a Fassbinder play?
I like angry students. I think that students need to be angry to have a point of departure for finding themselves and identifying what it is that they want to fix or things to which they want to write their own responses. And so I enjoy the angry students, and we're going to check this out, and they come into class the next day. Why did you have us read this? You had us read all of those. Why did we have to read this? Well, why didn't you like it? And then they just go, and the class runs itself, and they can talk about it structurally. They can talk about it in terms of content, and suddenly we're going to do a series of staged readings of, yes, do that. Do all of those things. But I think they have to read that material, because otherwise I've sheltered them, and they have a false sense of what they're going to encounter when they leave our classrooms.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah, I teach Valerie Solanas' play Up Your Ass sometimes with the Scum Manifesto, and we get all kinds of responses.
Manifesto is always a good thing to toss in there, yeah.
To that response. So while we're on the subject of teaching, you've taught so many playwrights, so many people claim allegiance to you. When I was at an AFA conference this summer, and it was the round table for the triangulation series, and I mentioned that, you know, you were going to finish your degree and what that meant to me and how I was looking forward to that. And at the end of my little 3-minute conversation, the entire room stood up and clapped, and people came up to me throughout the conference and said, I took Paula Vogel's class, I took this workshop, I couldn't be happier that this is happening to her. I mean, so you have taught everyone in this country who is a working playwright, it seems like, and so many award-winning playwrights. I mean, we don't even have time to make that list right now. And it's women and people of color and queers, and it's a brave new world. How did you do that?
When I arrived at Brown as an ABD,
that's the anger right there. Yeah.
My chair took me aside and said, "Look, the reason that we hired an ABD is there's already been a proposal to do away with playwriting. You have 3 years to turn it around." Now, at the time, and the reason that I went for the job, my lover at the time had just been diagnosed with MS. And we weren't allowed to have same-sex benefits back there, but we needed the salary very, very much. And I have to say, somebody saying, hey, we we're going to do away with your job in 3 years, is really kind of wonderfully motivating. And the other thing I have to say is that I had all of this inspiration, particularly from Bert States, who really encouraged me in terms of the playwriting, that I thought, I wonder if I could create a system where I give everybody what I wish I had had. Bert did incredible mentoring, but he, and I loved his, the one play of his I got to read. But it wasn't possible in that point in time, and may not be now, and this is what I'm raising as a question, that one could be both a faculty member and an artist in equal parts with the scholarship. And he gave up the playwriting. So I started thinking, okay, I really need this job. How would I construct a program? And, you know, the idea of bake-offs is something that, I don't know if you have heard about this, but I devised this thing with friends because we couldn't get produced, that we would take a classic play and then we would write a bake-off of that play in 48 hours and come in with it. So for example, and I've been doing this now for 40 years with writers, so I'll come into the room and I'll say, okay, we're all gonna read Tirso de Molina's The Stone Guest. Now we're gonna read Molière's Don Juan. Maybe we'll toss in an opera or two, and we're gonna read von Oravat's Don Juan Comes Back to the Wars. Okay, guys, here you go. We're gonna set the clock. 4 o'clock Friday, whatever you do in the next 48 hours comes out of it. You do not, if you go to sleep, you can't add on 8 hours. So you have 48 hours to bring in pages. You must write a play with a ghost, a statue, a master, a servant, sword play, and a moment of coitus interruptus. See you in 48 hours. And then to have 10 writers stumbling in the room with, you know, hot from the printer, pages, and then to spend perhaps 20 hours reading out each other's bake-off and to see what 10 or 20 minds can do. We've done possession bake-offs, we've done whatever. You know, it's things that you can do within a curriculum that doesn't either break the budget, but also doesn't kill anyone who may be doing 5 courses, right? It's saying to them, okay, go, guys, come back, show me. That is just extraordinary. So. There wasn't any real particular secret other than me going around the country and going into the office of a theater company, particularly smaller companies, African-American companies. I went to Irene Fornes and Intar. I went to, you know, the scrappy little companies that probably lasted 3 years, if we're lucky. And I'd say, who among you is writing plays, but they're holding down 3 jobs. You have anybody? Can you send me some of their plays? And then for the first 10 years, like I remember Irene Fornes said, I'm giving you my jewel. And she gave me the first play of Nilo Cruz, which was remarkable. And I went to Nilo and I said, listen, I'm hoping I can recruit you to come to Brown. He went, you want me to come to Providence, Rhode Island? I said, yes. He said, I've only lived in LA, Miami, and New York. I said, I promise you, whatever you're thinking New England is like, it's not like that. I promise you, I promise you. But again, it's the sort of thing that can be a backbreaker, and I'm sure you know this, I had to raise the soft money first so that the tuition was paid. And the university had to be open enough that I could do a pedagogical training so that all of my playwrights taught freshmen their second year so that they got a stipend, so that they didn't go into debt, which is exactly what you're doing right now. This is exactly what you're doing. This is the critical and crucial part of being able to find people. Look, I mean, I called Cornell because I'd been turned down by Yale School of Drama. And I'd wanted to be a playwright, and I didn't know what else to do. And I put my head on the table, and I wept. And I had heard, because I was taking graduate dramatic literature at Catholic University, that's another subject, that Cornell had an interesting program. And at the last moment, I called the graduate, the person who was the graduate studies director. It turned out to be Bert States. And I said, I know I'm very late on my application.
is there any way that I can apply? And he said, we just had somebody fall out as an applicant. When can you get the application? I got the application. It took all of my courage to call up again. And he said, Ms. Vogel, we're admitting you. We can only give you tuition. We have no stipend. And I just said, I type 80 words per minute. So it was that I had just been doing factory work. I had been doing secretarial work. I didn't buy clothing, as everyone here knows, in a store until I was 34 years old. God bless the Salvation Army. God bless Jimmy Carter for giving food stamps to graduate students. These are the ways we've eroded the safety net that opens the door of accessibility, which when I know what that takes in a university to safeguard your graduate support, that makes things possible. I hope it gives you pleasure. The day that Nilo got his MFA, a terminal degree, and I could call him Professor Cruz is a remarkable, remarkable day. Do you know what I mean? And that is the difficulty right now. As we're falling back, I think, into a more oligarchical structure, how do we find the soft money? How on the top of everything else you're doing do you have enough time to go to the Foundation Center or find an individual who will say, you know what, here's a graduate stipend for next year? And the fact that we have to continually come back to this point is horrifying to me. That this isn't all, I hate these terms. So we were talking about this, I think, soft money and hard money. If women were running development from the very beginning, do you think we'd be calling it soft money and hard money? But that the university can't or doesn't, or that we're having different priorities, so that the graduate support, that should be the thing that is always there on, you know, in every department. I know I'm preaching to the converted, but that's a lot of in-house politicking and pressure.
And so how do you do that? How do you be one of the greatest teachers of drama in this country? And that's true of you and Irene Fornes. That's absolutely true. And so how do you do that and raise money and write plays that win Pulitzer Prizes? How do you do that, Paul?
Well, by the way, the reason I was interviewed for the job at Brown for a tenure track was because they turned down Maria Irene Fornes, who's one of my gods, for a tenured position at Brown. And I knew that. And so when I got the job, I wrote to Irene and I said, they turned down Jesus with tenure and put John the Baptist on the tenure track. The truth of the matter is that there's not, everyone here in the university is overworked. Everybody is overworked in the university. So to go to colleagues who are doing the service of being a dean or being the provost or being whatever that are also overworked really means coming in, first of all, in a very sweet way, letting them know that I'm not going away. And I'll be here next week trying to get an appointment because I just love dropping in and seeing you. The other thing, though, is if we can be playful and creative with structure, to come in and say, hi, I'm going to ask that the stipends be put in place, but there's a way to do this. I figured it out. If we have them teach the intro courses for freshmen, if we get the graduate committee to pass that, the graduate school to pass that, and to agree to that, we're actually going to be saving money. If the departments, and it did, it actually did. It worked out perfectly. You know, so being able to sort of think forward, the hard thing that we all know is every 2 to 3 years there's a new provost. Every 2 to 3 years there's a new dean. So you have to renew the campaign all over again. But I do have to say that, as you can tell from coming back here to get my PhD today, there's a side of me that delights in never going away. And that just kind of cheerfully thinks, okay, and I've done this with institutions. I'm still approaching Lincoln Center. They have never produced me. They never will. I adore the people at Lincoln Center. They're doing all of my students. I get to see their work at Lincoln Center.
And I'm just going to blithely come back and say, hi, I have a new play. Would you like to read it? In a strange, bizarre way, it becomes more and more fun. As the years go by, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think the kind of ego you have to have. I mean, I remember going on the job market for the first time when I finished my PhD, and I got so many rejection letters, they just stacked up, and I thought, I have to do something with these, so I started wallpapering my office, and I thought, when I finish, if I don't have a job, then I have to do something else. But so I did three walls, and I was like, woo, it's not looking very good, and then there it was.
Now, see, one of the things that I do for all of my writers is I ask them to show me their rejection letters. And then I do an interpretive dance with the rejection letter. And I said, do you understand that this is actually a 10% cutoff? You got up into the top 10%. Can I tell you why? Did you actually read the letter? You're feeling rejected. This is a person who just said, will you please send me your next play? Which means it got past the 50% rejection, it got past the 75%. You're up in the top 10%, and someone who has a desk where their computer is disappearing with the stacks of piles of plays wrote you a personal letter. This is a very good day. Will you please write back every person who sent you a rejection letter and say thank you so much, mention them by name, I know how little time you have. Thank you for your encouragement. The name of my next play, even if you haven't started it yet, is, and I will be sending it to you. And within 7 years, all of the rejection actually turns into, hi, we have an opening. Would you please send us your latest play? Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's, but that's what you're doing as mentors. What we're doing as mentors, right? Exactly that. Will you look at your letter? How do you keep going back, et cetera, and so forth? And the truth of the matter is, it's very difficult at this time in my life for me to back away from being a regular faculty member. I have loved it. It's sustained me. But it's time for me to dare myself to catch up with the writers that I've worked with and loved and respond to their plays. And, you know, time is limited. Time is limited. But the extraordinary relationships and plays, because I didn't get my PhD, I've gotten 40 years of education continually without a completion until this moment in time from Lynn Nottage, from Sara Rule, from Chiara Houdiz, Gina Gianfrido, et cetera, and so forth, you know? And I think in a way we don't take a moment of time. It's hard. It's an emotional relationship. To come back and see people who were my students here is an emotional phenomenon and a wonderful thing. And we don't allow ourselves a moment to take that pleasure or perhaps really recognize how very important it is. Certainly our families know. Certainly our loved ones know what incredible work this is. And again, you know, it's a phenomenon that happens to all of us as overworked faculty, as overworked students. I mean, I don't think anybody knows until they're on the other side that each student is a household name, that you've changed the DNA of your faculty mentor, and that they look at the world differently because of you. It takes, not until we teach, do we suddenly turn around and go, oh my God, Marvin, I was such a pain in the ass. I really recognize that now. And yet, you know, you and Bert and James Clancy, you know, persevered. So there, I don't want to demonize the system that we're in terms of higher education.
Has there been a particular student or two who changed the way you write or changed your process of writing?
I'd never admitted anyone who didn't apply with a play where I didn't know how they did it. And I would have a gut response. I couldn't articulate it. It thrilled me. I was scared. I didn't understand why I was responding. And I usually when I ask people to join, you know, I would say, I want you to come to Brown. I want you to teach me what you're doing. And here it is, first it was one generation different, then it was two generations different, now it's three generations different. in the time that we have of 2 to 3 years, I would like to be able to articulate what your plays do so that I can talk to artistic directors and literary managers to help speed the translation process of what you're doing on the page. You're doing it very well. How do we do that three-dimensionally? So I have to say that by and large, with only a few exceptions, there wasn't, I've had an incredibly luxurious life. There wasn't a single playwright that didn't change the way I looked at theater. Really remarkably blessed that way. All very original voices. I mean, one of the things that I feel is that oftentimes perhaps colleges are teaching people to write like, or here's the one template of how to write a play in that kind of Sid Field's Hollywood way. But the ones that manage to get through are the ones who are recreating a world that I've never seen. You know, think about, is there another Adrian Kennedy in the world? No. But you're not the same after you read Movie Star, right? So it's an incredible luxury. And I mean, you're not reading the same thesis twice. You're not reading the same criticism, critical overview twice.
Well, I want to make sure that we leave some time for you to ask questions. So if you would like to use the mics, it's just because it's being recorded and then we can have that. But if you're close, you can also just stand up and say your question. I have a lot more to ask, but I don't want to be greedy because I've already had a lovely afternoon too.
Any help with a second act needed out there? Yes.
I'd like to turn the conversation back, if you will, to Cheryl Mash, with very due respect.
That's fantastic. No, sorry, I've just had a wonderful two-hour conversation about, let's talk about Cheryl Mash. Let's also, if you don't mind me, turning away from theater for a moment to something that I find very specific to Cheryl Mash. That I feel that I want Indecent to be about the play and the troupe that performs God of Vengeance. But Cholam Ash is a really interesting writer and man, and he was actually a contender for the Nobel Prize. And what's interesting is the young man who wrote the incendiary play, God of Vengeance, where his mentor in the living room told him to burn it on the first read, that actually disrupted some of the mentorship, moved away from theater and started writing remarkable books. By the time he was 35 years old, he had a 4-volume anthology of his work. And that was then he went on to write. What happened, I think, or this is my theory, after The God of Vengeance was basically shut down for obscenity, but really, in terms of, I think, the climate of anti-Semitism, is that he decided that he would write books that would enable Christians to see the Jewish people as having the same common root. So way before his time of being ecumenical, he was writing books, his Christological novels, that were basically redefining Jesus and the prophets as Jews. Now, the difficulty is always timing. For a man who did not write or speak in English and who depended upon his Yiddish translators and his Yiddish publishers, he started writing these novels to try to help stem the anti-Semitism. But it was seen by his fans and his publishers, and particularly Abraham Kahan, who was a very influential editor, to say the least, it was seen as being anti-Semitic in that he was accused of having become a Christian, of being an apostate, at a time when the Jewish people were being rounded up by the Nazis. So again, these novels started coming out in 38, 39, and rather than backtrack, and this seems very similar to the young man who took the first manuscript and said, great, we're going to take it to Berlin and get it produced there, he continued. He wrote The Nazarene. He wrote a book about the mother of Mary. And it was completely turned upon. Nobody would publish him, and really became an outcast in America, so much an outcast that there were incidents in which he was attacked with stones. People spit on him. I recently found out from the grandson of Sholem Ash that Sholem Ash came from Israel to Vancouver to attend a bar mitzvah, and people wouldn't allow him into the temple. And he had to say, you can't not allow me in a temple to offer prayers for the dead. It was a stunning, stunning, heart-sickening reversal for a man who really was seen in the ways, I suppose, that we would say Isaac Bashev is singer, or, you know, the ways that we would look. He was an international star of Yiddish literature. That part is not indecent. I wanted to just concentrate on God of Vengeance, to sort of ask the questions, which I think is a fair question to ask. And it is a question that I see, for example, Latino and Latina writers grappling with, or Chinese American writers grappling with. How, in a society which is seen as American white people, do we present our community, is not a question that has aged one whit since the God of Vengeance. But I kind of want to toss that out of there. I mean, it really does bring up, I think, a perpetual dilemma of when do we self-censor ourselves as a community that has been marginalized? When do we only perform within the tent? And when can we bring work outside the tent? And I can't think of a more vivid example of someone who paid a price for those questions than Sholem Ash, whose, you know, work I know that a lot of people are still reading, but less than I think should be reading. It would be grand to see more people read him, bring him back. But the other thing that's interesting is recently in New York, I encountered a woman who said, so you're bringing in this new play about Sholem Ash and God of Vengeance. I said, I am. She said, that wasn't good. What Sholem Ash did wasn't good. And I'm like, it's still alive and a hot button right now, that people feel that he turned on the Jewish people for looking at Christ as a Jew. Interesting, huh? What do you think?
It's a fascinating biography. And if I could just add to that, he spent from 1940 on working to raise money for refugees in Europe and getting people out of Europe.
Yes, he did.
Worked with Einstein on that.
Yes, he did.
And some of his other novels, when not controversial, I'm saying, are still acclaimed, such as East River.
Yes, East River is extraordinary. And to say that, it wasn't just in the 40s. I mean, in 1919, he was investigating pogroms. You know, he was part of the American Joint Committee. So this is a man who regularly traveled into Europe and presented his findings to the State Department. And I think, I mean, the notion of what it meant to be a Yiddish writer and the responsibility to the community and to activism and to social and economic justice at that time, what that meant, and I think very much his mentor, Peretz, I.L. Peretz, is very, very moving, you know. So worth to look at him and his novels for that. Anything else that we should know in terms of Sholem Ash?
That he didn't hesitate once he criticized the shtetl for hypocrisy, among many other things, and that the fact that everybody knew what was going on, he didn't hesitate to take that play to Berlin and Lowry's.
Right, right. I mean, it's the killing of the messenger. Now, he didn't get killed on God of Vengeance, but I think that the truth-telling that he continued, and particularly, I think Abraham Kahan, who was this influential editor, had a great deal of influence in determining the legacy of Sholem Ash. I don't know if you agree with that.
He's one of many who pass judgment without thinking fully about the questions that were raised.
Right, right, yeah. I was really kind of excited because in New Haven, an undergraduate approached, and she realized that at Yale, the Beinecke has Sholem Ash's papers and has Henry Weinberger's papers. And on the spot, she changed her undergraduate thesis. So, you know, it's kind of thrilling in this moment of time. And the other thing that's thrilling in this moment of time, I don't know if people here have heard the Klezmatics. Lisa Gutkin of the Klezmatics, the violinist, is one of the composers on this. And so it's been really interesting working with collaborators within the Klezmer community, where we've just been working with, I consider a young man in his 70s, who came to New York from Europe and joined the Volksbühne in 1969 and worked with Ida Kaminsky. So it's interesting now having people who are saying Yiddish is not dead. Don't say that this is a dead culture. This is a very alive culture that's coming back. And one of the things that I found very, very moving, didn't realize, is how many Yiddish camps there are in Poland in the summer where children are being taught Yiddish again. So, I mean, it's really kind of an interesting perspective. There's nothing historical about this material to me. I don't know if that you feel the same way about God of Vengeance. And
I think you live with it for so long that it's readily available to you in the same way that the news on Facebook, you know, ends up in your feed, because it remains important and part of your consciousness and goes on to inform other work, whether it be creative or other forms of writing.
Right. Yeah. I'm working with an extraordinary director on this who is, her parents are survivors, or her grandparents, and who was initially literate in Yiddish. I'm not. But it's been extraordinary, and very much for me as a kind of outside eye, because of course I know only the bad words in Yiddish, and that's not really knowing Yiddish at all. But being able to hear music through the piece recreated by this Klezmer band does that kind of theatrical trick, where suddenly we're in 1906 and we're hearing the songs, and that's been a great part of this. Other
questions?
Well, thank you very much for the talk and congratulations again.
Thank you.
My question goes back to the notion between theory and practice and what it means to now be a practicing artist for all of these years, and then to now have your degree. There's always this schism or this conversation surrounding the relationship between artists, practitioners, and sort of theorists and people that write about it. So what does it mean now to be in the conversation as someone who's doing both? Sort of looked upon as doing both, because that's what the degree sort of confers.
The degree does confer that, but I have to say very respectfully, I've been working now with many, many artists who have been doing extraordinary theory. So you cannot work on an Anne Bogart production and not talk about theory. I think that this is a false divide. And I have to say that one of the blessings that I received from my committee in the 1970s, what was very alive was the Stanford PhD program, where you must be a practitioner as well as a scholar or theorist. The truth of the matter, particularly as I keep working with younger writers, is to see how very much their work comes from theory. So I've worked, for example, with Deborah Stein, who was an original member of Pig Iron, and whose work thrills me. I don't know why we keep constructing that divide. I could never think about going into a room and starting on a new piece and not asking David Safran for a reading list and not asking him for thoughts and not asking other theorists in the room. Recently, we just had, I've been using David as a kind of sounding board for his suggestions and getting reading lists. Recently, bringing in Alyssa Solomon and saying, okay, tell me, please tell me right now, how is the sexuality reading to you? What questions is it bringing up? It, you know, this is a divide that never existed in 19th century Germany, in a way, or the notion of playwrights working as dramaturgs in large theaters. It's the American theater, I think, has caused that kind of rupture. And very specifically, because it costs way too much money to do this, I'm really very lucky. I've thought, I don't care whether or not they get more than one production. I'm going to do three plays with a larger scope that are basically based on a historical conversation and a theoretical conversation. So I had veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan as my dramaturgs in the room when I was doing Don Juan Comes Home from Iraq. I was given extraordinary psychoanalytic theory by people at the VA. You know, it's just, why would we think of that as a divide? It is one of the things that I think theater and performance departments wrestle with greatly. And I think it's continual. We're always having the same conversation. And it doesn't seem to go away. I guess I kind of hoped it would. And the truth of the matter is, it takes a lot of bandwidth and dedication to become a theorist where you're having that conversation, which I do not have. But it doesn't mean that I can't sit down and read something and say, okay, explain Judith Butler to me. Or, you know, I'm very, very fortunate in that as part of women's studies and interdisciplinary studies, I've had colleagues who have basically been my dramaturg. People in contemporary or comparative literature departments who have given me reading lists on Japanese theater when I need it, and who will talk about the metaphysics of the no ghost. You know, it's so, you know, one of the things I think that those of us in this room who are called upon, it's like we have to keep bringing back in that interdisciplinary glue, but within our own field, within our own department, and not to be divided like that. I have never met a scholar who wasn't an artist. They may say that they're not, but when I was here, Marvin, you were directing gorgeous plays. Bert was writing plays. James Clancy was acting and directing. The ability to hold on to that in our careers as we go forward is so crucial and important.
Well, please join us in the lobby. We have some wine and some snacks to share, and please come up and ask your questions of Paula there. We'll continue the conversation. And join me in thanking Meghan, and we hope you come and see the production tomorrow. And Paula Vogel, Dr. Vogel, thank you so very much.
Thank you both so much.